Okay, so good evening. So tonight I'm just, like I put it here, just the messenger. My name is Brahim Ahmadishaf. I work for ESTAR. If you know me well, I'm into FPGA. So all my papers have to have some FPGA aspect. This paper is a paper I found quite recently. It's actually, I don't remember actually the date of it, but it's not really a recent paper. And I will show at the end of the presentation that actually there's some new modules that you can actually buy, which have really, really good performance. And this is actually more of a design project from some years ago. My interest in FPGA is really for my work and for my background in signal processing. And I'd like to see with some people who are into radio amateur, like this young man behind there, into how to combine some of the FPGA design and some of the communication aspects. And I came across this paper, which is an FPGA based transceiver module from this guy called John Stephenson. So this is his indicator thing, and he's from California in America. So basically he had a little platform that he designed, and he really tried to get a motivation from the fact that what you buy is usually very expensive for that type of communication systems, and he wanted to design some very small module that can do the job compared to the sort of equipment that you can get. And also it's more of a design study with loads of different modules and FPGA aspects of it. So the hardware is actually based on a quite small Xilinx Spartan 3 FPGA, and he really put some specification on having an analog to digital converter and digital to
bigger than Papilio, smaller Papilio.
Yes, it's the Papilio 1500, basically.
Yeah,
so it's quite a small one.
Yeah, compared to yours, but for like comparison,
yes.
You can put easily 16-bit microprocessor.
That's what it's actually doing. That's the whole.
Yeah,
It's quite a small hardware that you can play with, and so he really wanted to have some sort of high throughput in terms
I'm
not sure. I'll check it later.
What? 32 bit?
I think it's a risk. It's
like
a risk. It's a processor risk.
Oh, the processor.
No.
ADC.
So it's really here. It's the amount of data that is really 80 megasample per second, and also with the processor, you can also plug basically an internet port, which is here in the middle
this
here.
Sample, right? If you look at the specs, actually it's like 80 megasamples per second.
Yeah.
100 megabits per second.
This is the
just to use the bandwidth, they would have to have some kind of RAM, static RAM inside.
Yeah,
they don't have it.
The Spartan has some block RAM inside.
Yeah, but it's like 64 kilobytes.
Yeah, but you will see afterwards the thing. It's actually not really using a lot. Basically, it's using really.
Yeah, but that's too little. 80 megasamples. That's.
It goes really through. It's basically it doesn't really store
a lot.
It's not like sampling like sound or. So basically,
yeah, that's
it's really a small.
You have to do all reduction or data reduction on FPGA, and you cannot do something like. The hacker app does that, it just dumps your raw data.
But in this case, basically this is more because of the frequency of the modulation, etc., rather than really the amount of data you want to keep. You're basically sending samples or...
But the
transmission is actually not so...
ADAC?
Sorry?
How ADC has... How many bits has ADC?
I think it's 12. I can look in the... I have some slide of the schematic at the end. So basically he has this Ethernet connector which he wants to basically pump data through 4 megabits flash ROM. That's basically an external flash ROM. I can't remember where it is. It's probably this one. He has some low speed DAC, a GTAC port which is to communicate with the FPGA and program it, etc. And a RS-285 port just to debug. He also has some 10-pin header here. These are the standard basically connectors when you want to connect sensors and things like that. So really it's a small little card that he basically designed, and I guess the whole exercise for him to basically look into what is actually required to actually have an FPGA transceiver module. So if we look at the schematic here, the diagram, the central here is a CPU, and then basically it talks to some RAM for the different functionalities, and then it has some CRC, some filters, I2C to an audio codec, that's quite standard. It has some codec, decoder, encoder, and then here it has an SPI going to some flash, and it also can talk to UART. This is quite standard. Modem and VTB decoder. So the whole system is really to show some sort of communication, sort of implementation.
So the thing is, it has say 2 kilobytes of RAM. Does it mean that what is the packet size that you can push through FFT?
Most of the thing is 16-bit. I think if you look later on the other side, 16-bit data that you push.
And 16-bit, but how many samples?
For this, I don't remember the exact.
But that limits your available frequency for further processing.
I don't judge the choice of his stuff. I'm just presenting his work in a sort of bigger context. Here, I'm not sort of criticizing, you know, 4K, 2K.
I just wonder what are the main big weaknesses, or what are the you know. Operating parameters that you can
When you see a system like this, you can obviously have much more RAM into you know, a more recent FPGA. You can have
you can buy 64-bit.
Even with a Spartan 6, you can get much more than what you have here. The whole issue is more of implementing on an FPGA a whole system that can do the transmission video matter.
But then again, you may be interested in specific bandwidth, because here the RAM.
The bandwidth is tends to be the issue of the DAC. It's really the DAC, or the throughput you can go through the DAC.
Oh, the DAC is 80 mega samples per second. That's pretty good, but I don't think you will make 80 mega samples unless the signal. So you could not that's the common coding is the orthogonal. You know that you do FFT on the whole packet. To fill in 80 MSPS, that's 40 megahertz. With this FFT, I don't think it's possible.
This is the paper. If you read the paper, he's doing some communication with it. I'm not.
But he will not saturate.
He has a pretty MSPS. Exhaustive explanation of all of his design. For me, the main issue here on the sort of paper like this, which I find interesting, is really that he explained all the different circuitry that are basically used in those in this sort of transceiver module. So the signal here is analog. Analog here. You get sample. You see 12-bit sampler. Then you have some CIC filter. The other way is
what's
the DAC.
CIC
is a com filter. I will go through the slides to get really show.
No problem.
So really, from an FPGA or hardware point of view, each different blocks, like say this one is a filter, a clipper, a resample. He actually explained all the different blocks in his paper. So from someone who wants to learn how this is actually implemented on an FPGA, this is a good paper that gives you a broad image, representation of all the different building blocks of a transmitter.
One question here.
Sorry?
Do I see correctly that it allows you to pre-mix ADC with DAC signal?
I think this one becomes a sort of exclusive. Either you get, then.
Oh, so this is only one way.
I assume so. Although otherwise, here you can go that way.
Yeah.
But you can also go that way and then all the processing to the to the baseband thing. So here it's like a two-port thing. Mm-hmm. You send data and then on the other side. And this is this one is doing the job of going that way, but also this is basically demodulator modulator. And the same thing. So, in terms of system, you have quite a complex blocks, which, for example, here we are mentioning about the FFT. This is a 16-bit. It used some of the RAM for the CPU to read to write. The rest basically goes into the baseband output input. Some of a block called codec. That's a specific a block. Time recovery, FIFO, going to the CPU output. So those blocks there. I would say from an FPGA design, they're quite standard, and he's basically, for me, the interesting thing about this paper is that really showing all the different blocks and how they integrate and interrelate to actually have a full picture of a transmitter receiver. So afterwards he goes into some details about the different blocks that he basically implement. For example, the frequency that comes here, it basically gets, you know, summed, etc., goes to some ROM and then some output here. So the DSS, which is this direct digital synthesizer, this is like the master clock in a sense, to have some sort of emission and reception. And down the line, he actually also explained the different blocks, how he implement like the ROM, etc., the different buses. So it's quite detailed, and I haven't actually found I haven't really found any paper that go into such detail. This is quite simplified because there is some design choices. For example, in some parts here, this that tends to be registered at pipeline, the delay of some blocks here. But he doesn't go into too much detail, but at least I get an overall image and actually representation of all the different blocks. So it's easier to understand what is, you know, that sort of module and how you can also simulate those blocks even in software, because down the line this is done in hardware as a ROM, as a multiplier, etc. But you can also look at it from a software point of view, from a module point of view. So he also gets some algorithm from some original, let's say, Motorola note, and he gives some specific level or specific number of stage, bit width, etc., to basically also justify his design.
May I have a question to the previous one? So this is the digital resolution.
Yeah, so this one is a...
Does he use any kind of filter posted?
That's what afterwards. You end up with a CIC. So the CIC is a cascaded integrator COM filter. This is the implementation. And what you want basically here is that the FC that you have, the central frequency that you want to really focus on, the COM is like a COM filter, it's like a COM that you have, and all the different, I would say, the notch here, the stop band here, are exactly at 2FC. So it's basically all the different harmonics. You try to eliminate all the noise. So these are the type of signals that you can see that also in audio, some specific effect in audio are using this. But this is quite specific also for this, because what you want is the maximum amount of energy that goes into your antenna, in a sense, receptor or emitter. And then at those harmonics, there the signals gets, or the noise related to it gets attenuated. So afterwards, you can basically work out that, you know, he has some counter, he gets some gain here, and then the transmission reception, and then he gets, this is a subtractor, and then this is an additional adder, and then you end up with a big circuit here, and then it goes like this. Overall, this is also a CIC, is also quite a complex but known block in signal processing.
This is digital CIC.
Yes, yes. So the filters that
how
the
you synthesize it. When you synthesize it, do you have aliasing in the analog?
But that's the whole issue, is to keep it into the digital domain. The thing is, you sample and everything is done in the digital domain here. You don't want to have analog. The only analog part is the card with the DAC, the input of the DAC. Once it's inside, the issue is to have a fast FPGA doing all the filtering, all the decimation, all the thing. With a certain correspondence with an analog circuit, if you're actually doing it in analog domain in the first place. So FIR filters, these are standard filter also, and then you have some data that you pump into here, you have your coefficient in your other one, and then you do those multiply carry, and then you have an output here. So these are quite standard blocks. Of course, it doesn't actually say what are the filter coefficients, etc., but these are standard techniques that you can also apply, and these are quite a nice, I'd say, building block for you to implement in an FIR filter. Those filters you can also use for other projects, not only for communication, but other type of thing. That's quite specific. This is, I never came across that type of block. It's called a noise blanker, and it seems to do some quite specific delay thing with some reset. So this is something that is new even to me, knowing signal processing for many years. So this is kind of building block that is interesting to actually study and actually, you know, simulate itself and fit with some data and see what. Of course, there's some function here, let's say absolute value, that you need to implement. Usually it's with a lookup table, because this is 8 bits only. then you take the magnitude, you compare, you have a limit, and then at some point that sort of circuit basically reset the output here, so you have this effect of blanking the noise that you enter.
There's like a threshold, noise threshold blanking.
To be honest, I need to simulate it because you can represent this like as some sort of equation and see. But here it's like a delay line that you will basically blank or reset the fourth every so often because of the value. So this you need to basically.
If the magnitude is too low, then you just turn it off, sort of.
Must be something. Something here, for example, here you also have different stage with a single clock, and then you have a OR gate or a NAND gate.
Is it all open source hardware?
I cannot find the source code. So I need to email the guy.
The design of the board.
I find only that actually that document. I don't actually find the
just the paper describing.
Yeah. Initially, actually, I thought I would manage to get some of the code or something on the project, but I cannot find it.
But you can email him. He's
It should be. Yeah, I think the board he must have designed it to maybe sell it as a small project at some point. Or something,
Yeah, because it's like. It's almost Papilio, so it should be
Yeah.
You can possibly upgrade it with slightly larger Spartan or Spartan 6.
Sure.
Because they have similar pinout.
Mm. For me,
and you can upgrade it with
The motivation is not really to ask the code of someone. It's more like I can write the code to actually implement this one and see what is actually. Because those FIR filter, they are very standard thing. Mm. But this one, I don't know. So actually, this one is more interesting for me to try to tweak and see actually what.
So it seems that he knows more about digital radio than I do.
Yeah, it's quite a complex, and of course the whole system, because it's based on a CPU, has all those different registers you can tweak. So it's a bit like getting a datasheet of of a component saying if you tweak this one, the decimation you need to put the value here, etc. So down the line you could have even a Linux driver that actually poke those steps. Values.
So you can get the parameters by just playing in the radio for 15 minutes.
Yeah.
And you will know the response.
Yeah. I mean the whole thing here is that you see 8 bits here, 18 bits here. Which one of the 18 bits do you actually use here?
Yeah.
These are not always clear. So
sure.
There's also some box where suddenly there's two arrows and there's no source in the diagram.
Yeah.
So like, what's controlling this? You have to. Yeah.
In traditional ham radio transceiver, what if I remember correctly, what they do is that they try to filter out certain high frequency noise generated by cars, automobiles, and all that.
Yeah.
I believe that's what they also try to implement.
Yeah, this one is really the one that, minus 60 dB here, it gets, massively. Yes, this is after the oscillator,
The spurs for the oscillator.
Yeah, correct.
But within the whole system, unless I get the code, because basically it's a machine that, reads something, they do FFT, control everything, unless I get the overall, I would say, behavior of that transceiver, it's very hard. I could guess the FFT doing some FFT and try to get the spectrum, try to have this and that, but otherwise it's still only a specific view of his system. It's not the full, you cannot replicate it from that paper basically, but it's still an interesting paper from a pure hardware point of view. For example, automatic gate control. You have this in your phone, you have this in all sorts of equipment because you don't want to saturate. So you have, for example, 20 bits input, you have some shift register. Hold on. Oh, sorry. Yeah. Oh. Something wrong?
Looks like the projector gave up.
Yeah.
Is it?
It may be.
Your side is good, right?
Okay,
yes,
something.
No, that's the Mac Mini.
Suddenly my laptop went into some funny
You want to try to unplug and replug?
Yeah.
Or you can try and plug, replug at the splitter, wherever it is.
That's weird.
No. I can put a PDF. You have PDF?
Try to put crates on my machine, see if that helps. But he's getting Brahim's machine,
getting,
so that's not the problem. The problem is up from the
So it's not the laptop.
It's not.
No.
He can still capture the signal from here.
Oh.
But he can't push it up to the projector.
Oh.
Because remember, the engineers are actually doing the recording, so
they get
a signal first, then they split it, they capture it,
and
they put it up.
Okay,
so
it's okay. Then back to
Brian. So it's something to do with that.
Capture this thing on the massive.
Yeah.
I heard massive.
Well, you can't see them. Just, are we plugged in?
Yes.
It's still on, Max.
Come on.
So how does it work? You set up. You.
It goes in. It splits. One goes here. One goes to the projector. Through this guy.
AGC. So automatic gain control. So these are standard also blocks that basically have some. Measurement of the magnitude here, which feeds back into a control, and afterwards this is basically here some valid data, and somewhere here you can specify the attack and the release, and basically influence those. So it's basically feedback. There's a feedback of the signal, and you adjust. So this is like a classic, more or less classic AGC signal. A lot of tweaking parameters. I like the fact that. You end up with a system that can actually be poked with loads of parameters, and afterwards the whole thing runs. There's a resampling part. So the resampling here says may be switched for application with the baud rate that are large integer values of the ADC. So this becomes maybe the thing that you mentioned. You end up basically downsampling probably some of the other values if required. So for this, I mean those blocks, they tend to be all adders and then some sort of register that you specify which output from, and then some ROM that calculate things, and then those are pipelines, so you end up with registers to align the data. So down the line, those you have basically here OSR and the new sample, and then here you have end up with two output, and you have some counter in the middle, etc. There's a compressor and a clipper. So it takes the absolute values, it calculates some which one is the biggest, and afterwards it will interfere here, and this, depending on the gain, will multiply the 16-bit value by 16-bit here. And so here you can soften compress or basically clip the values at the output of the whole chain is not really clear in the thing, because you get all the different blocks but you don't get the overall. So for this
one, maybe a voice or sound
for the, but there's two here, so I assume it's for the receiver and transmitter, otherwise it wouldn't be. The voice is usually mono, no, when you have the microphone. So a lot of those paths, the data here tends to be two. And afterwards, later, there's this, this one. This is more or less like the modem, which uses a codec. So codec is a block which is like multi-stage, and you basically approximate a certain value depending on the input. So here you have X and Y and Z, and then it basically do some processing. So these are quite interesting because there's a lot of paper on codec in literature. So this is probably a specific implementation. And he mentioned a lot of, you see the rotating engine consists of three multipliers, 16-bit each of them, the 32-bit adder. So he really specify all the paths. And he also, in some of the part of the text, he also justify the number of bits, which is the basically precision of the data with the performance of his system. There's some time recovery aspect also in one of the block. So this tends to be some input that comes here.
I think, if I may note on the bits, if you have, say, 14-bit ADC, it's pretty normal if you don't sample, or do codec or another analysis, usually also don't sample, that you will get a much more accuracy.
Yeah, but here I think the path is typically 16-bit, I think,
so
because of the... if you use some BRAM in the data in FPGA, you have like 8-bit BRAM. So this is sort of standard thing. But a path of 22 bits, this is not a standard thing for macro processor. It's more on an FPGA design when you can adjust all the different bus width and everything. There's a null detector, so it's the same. These it's quite a good exercise to actually understand. You know, there's an input, the RAM. Output something from an address, that would be an address. The address would be the output of this adder. Then there's a feedback here, so this is tends to be some sort of accumulator, etc. There's a counter, and then at the end it splits. Some signals go to different part of the system. So this is quite abstract in a sense, but this is a second FIR filter, and it has also some registers. And then there's this FFT, so this is an important block in signal processing when you want to have the data in time domain and you want the frequency domain and get a spectrum of signals. And then you have usually all these blocks here are RAM, block RAM. So one of the specificity of FPGA is that you have two ports, port A and port B, and you can write and read. So you basically really have two write or two read. And you cannot read at the same or write at the same location. There's some sort of limitation, but these are also specific blocks of FPGA design that you can take advantage of. So the FFT, let's say, output can write into the RAM, and at the same time you could read some of the data, so you can accelerate things like this. So in one clock you can read and write. So this becomes more advanced from an FPGA design. And then there's this polar to rectangle conversion. So for this, I assume is the I and Q of those signals in RF when you have the intensity and the quadrature. And this, there's a circuit to do polar to rectangular conversion. So it's just a ROM, and afterwards is basically a selector here. And then the other way around is a rectangular to polar. So they have those distinction, and afterwards this. Select, and at the end is another. So here is the magnitude and the phase. So this becomes really the you interpret the data as a complex in mathematics. It's a complex variable with the magnitude and the phase. A lot of pre-calculated tables and also registers you can poke and pick. In communication, you usually have this cyclic redundancy check. which is you send some data and you also send some parity bits that calculate some syndrome or specific function of the data. And when the data is received, you check that those bits are right. If they are wrong, then it means that you have specific bits in error. So these are quite a standard, the bits go here, they XOR here, and at the end you have some output. So these are CRC circuits that allow to verify the good behavior of the transmission. There's also a VTB decoder, so that's a whole also big topic in communication. VTB is, I think that was 1970, the first few papers. So actually in my work, I actually use a flavor of this for some design. So this is a small VTB decoder, but it has all the different state and the distance between the different weights, etc. And the minimum distance get basically reused. And ultimately you try to find the path within the bits that has the smallest value, and then you basically choose this one as a good code word, it's called. Overall, there's also what we call BCH, so it's three researchers which have invented also a coder decoder which has specific behavior for communication. So this is also included. So actually, when
this is error correction.
Yeah. So when I actually first read the paper, there was this CPU, etc. But actually, there's FFT. There's a lot of functionality in there that actually can be really studied from a communication or system point of view. So this is basically that paper. I wish I could implement it the whole thing, but I think it's a bit of a long exercise. But for people who want to dive into communication and FPGA, I think it's quite a good introduction into all the different blocks. There's a big part in the appendix of the paper dealing with the RISC processor, how this, and recently with the Pavalela, there's all these boxes that like little board that actually have implement those multi-processor, multi-core RISC architecture. So I think this is for me also some sort of a background platform to actually look into. He basically doesn't really cite a lot of papers, but those quakes or winter packet sounding. This is his own publication as small articles, and this one QST. I assume that these are not magazine, but more like a publication. Yeah, publication for radio amateur.
QST is a less technical version. QA is more like a journal and
okay.
Discuss
okay.
A lot.
When I look for them, I don't find a specific URL.
Under the ARL, American Radio Review.
Okay. So that I'll look into some. Some are quite old papers, but they are usually introductory of this one I know because this one I used that back in my BNGS to actually synthesize sounds. So the Motorola DSP is quite familiar with this one.
Reading the start of the paper right now. They said that they're using it for HS and high-speed multimedia. You see, there was a project where they take all these wireless routers,
yeah,
and they use it to connect, make mesh networks
to make
computers.
Yeah.
So
there's a second paper I think he wrote after, which has this title with a mesh communication network.
It uses things like OFDM and all that.
Yes.
And
yeah.
Use more for digital.
So I assume he built that board to also implement. Like a bigger system. So this is really just to present that paper. It's not. I mean, it's quite. For me, it's FPGA, so it's not so technical. But it's right to show that FPGA can also be used for that kind of application. Mikhail mentioned, one can implement a lot of algorithms which are not about communication, but are other domains to accelerate. And so he actually provides also his the schematic. This is basically the part with the ADC and the DAC. It's actually the very poor quality. You can when you zoom, you cannot really distinguish the
so
thing.
The ADCs and the DACs are on board. Right?
Yeah, they're outside. Yeah. No, they're on the board, but
yeah.
No, they are. I'm not sure.
But they're not on the FPGA. They are a separate chip.
Yeah, separate chip. Yeah. I think because you cannot go to that amount of bandwidth.
Yeah.
And then you have this like simple oscillator with I think 80 megahertz oscillator. Yeah.
By the way, don't bother contacting the fella. He has is reported to have passed away.
Oh, okay. I didn't know. Okay.
Okay, that was morbid.
Okay. To light up the we're on video. Okay. So rest in peace. So by looking at those modules, there are some new design which are also looking at streaming video, etc. Using RF module, and you can find a recent thing from this Sidekick, which are very small PCIe. So actually this board, you can actually fit that into your PC because that's like the size of a, you can basically have a slot. It's a bit like the Bluetooth module used to have, etc. So those have, if you look here, they have a mega, so these become 70 to 6 gigahertz. And they have a connector to receive and some connector to emit. So those boards with an FPGA, which is a Zynq, this Zynq or Spartan, Arctic 7, this becomes a more modernized version of basically that small project. So if you're interested in some of these, I don't know about the price. I think it was more like I saw a flyer and I think I posted this into the group, but basically, they advocate that the issue is that having this FPGA here can also reprogram all the different modules that you want.
So I would say nice thing is that mini PCI you just put inside the laptop,
yeah,
and but connect to internal antenna. That
having a 7 gigahertz box here, why not? I don't know. I'm not sure. I mean, the Wi-Fi is 2.4 and then 5 something. 7
yeah.
gigahertz, I don't know, it becomes a bit but something like this, the port, those ports here,
so you need a filter after that.
No, it's connected to a bus. This is connected to your bus.
Yeah, I mean between antenna
on that side. I think it's a bit like those thing you end up with a small,
sounds
yeah.
like standard,
yeah,
connection.
Yeah.
So how do you
you mean these boards?
I wouldn't put this in a laptop, but if you put it in any of the small little mini PC things, you can just run the UFL out.
But they show that you can, you know, this is the format of a laptop module, and they use. I mean, used to have. I have that actually out of my old laptop. Those Bluetooth, Wi-Fi. You know, you used to clip and basically.
M2 is slightly more interesting because it's also used for SSDs these days.
Yeah, yeah.
So a lot of laptops, they just give you like two or three of those ports. One is used by the SSD, one's used by the Wi-Fi, and you can do whatever you want with the third.
And most of the time, the antenna is actually in those laptops. Actually, it's
but
outside
that,
the.
That's
the
for
thing.
High frequency.
Yeah.
But for low frequency, the thing is, you can just use Arduino because the antenna will be your main concern anyway.
But 70 megahertz.
And maybe. For this,
going through those pins of Arduino and antenna, I'm not sure. An FPGA for sure.
Yeah.
I mean, this is just, you know, this schematic or this sort of system is quite, you know, a small one. And then when you look now, I wonder even this one is a Kickstarter or something like that.
Full
I'm not sure. But this is more a modern version of things. And I assume that when they provide boards like this, see here the API software provide an easy interface. So this will have a Linux interfacing and API drivers, etc., for you to play with. Because I remember you showed something on your laptop once when we were in
PayPal.
Yeah,
but the thing is that's the other question I have. Here you have mini PCI, so you need a PCI driver.
Yeah.
All
that's standard in.
I have played with.
Oh, okay.
Have USB driver.
Okay.
So they have interface of USB serial or USB raw data stream, so streaming.
I assume that those projects will provide you know, interfacing
to have special drivers, I think.
Yeah, they probably provide it.
But the nice thing is that if they have,
there will eventually be a free one on Linux.
Yes, yeah, it has to be.
They would work better than HackRF because HackRF, when it tries to use the whole band, they will saturate.
It's bandwidth limited by the USB bus.
What's the bus of the PCIe mini one?
this is.
They're both PCIe on this one.
No, but compared to USB, compared to USB.
This is ridiculous.
I don't know.
Right?
Yeah. So this is a PCIe 2.0 X2 that is 8 gigabit per lane. So that's 16 gigabit on the mini PCIe one.
Oh, it's like lots of lanes.
Yeah, because
okay,
there's two lanes on
this. Okay. And the size is.
Probably would not. Just like, you know, lines directly to main memory.
Yeah.
Okay, that's my presentation. I think it's a. I think in the future I'll try to present something that has a demo, like something that, you know, works. Otherwise, it tends to be a bit more.
Maybe it would be possible to send an email to Guy and ask if he.
No, he said he passed away. He passed away. Apparently, he passed away.
He just passed away.
Yeah.
No.
Nah, 4 years ago. 4 years ago.
But the good news is that the ARL has picked up this work, and their team is actually working on it. Mm. For info, the ARL is not just Radio Society. They are actually a corporation, and they have the proper equipment, the labs, stations, and all that required to do all this kind of thing. It's only whether you see, some of the materials, they only give it to their members who have paid for the membership,
mm-hmm.
and all that, and they do publish all these on QXP and all that. In fact, if they do release it out for free,
association, the question is, somebody has to have motivation to push it. And the question is also how much they want to share.
Yes, true.
But most of the time they do. I mean, you know, the guy put the schematic on the internet. If he doesn't want to share, you don't put schematics.
That's the thing.
It's not
for playing with this. You need something like VHDL code.
I assume
and
that it's probably programming Verilog.
Not just, you know, abstract schematics, but ideally Eagle file if you want to quickly start.
To make the board,
unless
it's somewhere on one of those, you know, maybe he has the website himself, etc. I didn't look.
Because you need to modify that at some point, say you add the RAM. Yeah.
So I mean, the whole issue is that the whole system here is all in the FPGA. You know, all this is all FPGA. The UART is programmed on a few pins of FPGA. This is a connector, this is a chip. This is a connector.
So
this is a connect. Another chip. This is the FI RG.
Maybe just for
VHDL. Yeah. So, actually, some of these systems, I assume that they could also be migrated into Zinc.
Yeah.
Then you macro Blaze or something, and you have. But the issue is, how do you program all those fancy stuff inside?
If you have VHDL code, you know. Yeah. And also, a Cordic or FFT, this is the standard.
No, this
code
is standard,
that you
already
have on open course. Yeah. Or FIR.
I haven't actually looked in the open core whether there's some project
dealing. FIR,
no, but like a whole system like this? I don't know. I mean, in my case, I'm interested in that risk here because I read a lot of papers, and the trend in FPGA is to have a big
risk.
FPGA and a massive network of small processors that do a lot of stuff.
You should look at open risk.
Also, yes.
Open risk and risk V, risk 5, right?
Yep.
Yeah. The guy in NTU, some professor in NTU, work with those having mesh of risk 5 processors. So we try to see. No. Okay. Thank you very much. I'll leave.
Is if I would be trying to replicate it from scratch without any board design. For low frequencies, that probably doesn't matter, but for 5 gigahertz, there may be a matter how well you design your board, because you probably need a ground plane, you need to isolate the signal.
In my case, if I use one of my PGA from work, I would try to have a high-speed port, which is usually a BNC, a proper BNC, then you have two into a board which has those, and those analog device has those boards. somehow there's already some.
So you already have.
Well, I went
ADC
to a course. I went to a course.
ADC.
Yeah, I went to a course when they have a Zinc, and we bought two kits basically with antennas, and there's an AD 9000 something. You simulate basically all of this into it. But it costs money. I mean, it costs money.
You have standard Zinc board and standard ADC board.
On it, I think it's an analog AD. There's a chip, a transceiver chip. So whether it's interface with a high speed port or whether it's actually a bus. I assume it's actually a high speed port. I went to a course like this, so once I got those boards, maybe you can have a demo into a thing or something.
Maybe at Hackway.
Yeah. The issue is that they you go to the course, and afterward, 2 months later, they say there's a delay because of some sourcing thing, and you're like, when does the board? But it's more like from a radio amateur or ham radio, the blocks in the FPGA and understanding the sort of behavior inside. And having when I first read the paper, the fact that there's a CPU, like a whole CPU like this, it's quite already quite advanced. It's not the basic FPGA blocks or something like that. So that's the interesting thing for me.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.